was a parallel, a coincidence, I think, but this is how the world often works. But again, Anna, thank you.
The first play, or the video of a play that you will see, is titled Andy Warhol's Last Love. He has very little to do with our play, except that he is here in a masked person. The performance was created in 1978. This was our very first play in New York City. And it was the second in terms of it's situated in a storefront. All right. This play consists in three parts. The first part, Aliens on the Second Floor, is titled. It takes place in the second floor room of Eva and Stephan, a private place, somehow bridging our Budapest period when we performed in our apartment to the storefront that was in the West. It was a longitudinal room where, because the place we rented was before a club, was elevated. Part of the room was elevated all the way. So that was the stage where the aliens, the performers, are. You will see, they look like normal people. They are not aliens, but we were aliens from the point of view of immigration. Also, you will notice that the play hinges on aliens are coming to Earth, and science fiction is part of the story. The audience was sitting on the floor on cushions in the other half of the room. Part two will be downstairs in our storefront area. It's a theater. The audience is sitting on risers like you are, but instead of a screen, there is a window to the street. But in front of it hangs a sheet on which a film is projected. It's titled An Imperial Message, inspired by Franz Kafka's parable, An Imperial Message. And you'll see the third part is Interview with the Dead, because at the end of the film, Andy Warhol shows up with his guest, a witch, and he does a Polaroid of her and enters stage. It coincides. We try to imitate it in the video. So you see them arriving on the screen, and you see them arriving behind, because it's translucent, in life, in the same spot. Then they enter the door, the witch does her ceremony, and there is an interview, and Warhol interviews her, and then Ulrike Meinhof arrives. She's a the incarnation, I would say, of her childhood, and she shot him as way back then it happened to him. And that's the play.
And I think it's still worth saying that the company in Budapest chose to perform in their own apartment because it was not possible behind the Iron Curtain to really do their theater in the normal theaters. But after a play and a song in one specific play, they were given the opportunity, the choice, or you stop to do the work of theater or you leave the country and never come back. And they chose to leave straight in Rotterdam, right in home for a while, and then came to New York.
Yes.
Yeah. Regrets.
Yes.
I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew.
I'm just saying an emotional goodbye, and Rick is telling them, I've said it before and I'll say it again.
WYNY, New York's fastest growing radio station. Sunday morning with Mike McCann. Welcome in. Did you hear the big news in the world of mass transit? Get this, the Titanic will rise again. Seems out of San Diego, they're going to build a brand new superliner, almost a virtual duplicate of the original Titanic. The company name that's building it, get this, the Transit Risk Company.
To the inhabitants of Earth, you must make your death public. On the night of May 9th, 1976, in a special isolation cell of the Samham prison, where I was confined without sentence by order of the chief prosecutor of the Federal Republic of Germany, as a co-leader of the Red Army faction. The rope was tightening around my neck the moment of losing my mind, suddenly I lost my perception, but regained all my consciousness and discernment. An alien made love with me. If it is true, as certain newspapers write, the traces of sperm were found on my dress. These could have been the traces of the intercourse. After making love, I could state that my consciousness went on functioning in a new and uninjured body. Afterwards, the alien took me to a special planet which belongs to the Andromedas, to society that treats time and space with intensity, gentleness, discipline, and freedom. Over. For the Intergalaxy 21 Revolutionary Committee. You must make your death public. This is the only way that we may know about it, that we may come and free you from the final, unavoidable, and meanest means of exploitation from death. You must make use of all the possibilities of the aggressive capitalistic mass media. Publicize the time and location of the next death in the newspapers, on radio, and television. You must put up posters and distribute flyers. The Intergalaxy 21 Revolutionary Committee makes arrangements on the basis of your information. Is completely annihilated in death and so seemingly. You must die with intensity, gentleness, discipline, and freedom. Problem of transporting the new body. Where you always forget your personal and pathological death. No, there is no occultism and no magic, no obscure science, no hidden secret, no unrevealed truth. There is no necessity to accept death mass-produced arranged mechanically by the health institutions. This evanescence reflects dreadfully its uniform, cliché-like life. Don't let your life come to an end. Be done with it. Over. This is Uri Kamenhof speaking for the Intergalaxy 21 Revolutionary Committee. Make your life public, and your death shall also become public. Out. As the rope was tightening around my neck, at the moment of losing my mind, suddenly I lost my perception, but regained all my consciousness and discernment. An alien made love with me. If it is true, as certain newspapers write, the traces of sperm were found on my dress. These could have been the traces of the intercourse. After making love, I could say that my consciousness went on functioning in a new and uninjured body. Afterwards, the alien took me to a special planet which belongs to the Andromedas, the society that treats time and space with intensity, gentleness, discipline, and freedom. Over. You must make use of all the possibilities of the aggressive capitalistic mass media. Publicize the time and location of the next death in the newspapers, the radio, and television. You must put up posters and distribute flyers. the Intergalaxy 21 Revolutionary Committee makes arrangements on the basis of your informations.
Of love. Love will fix anything. Ashford and Simpson. I'm Carlos Stairs. 1028. Got Blondie for you. And the man from Mars. Don't forget, sometime this week, Dale Rees will be drawing a card for $9,200. Keep it on 92. KTU.
Has sent a message to you the humble subject, the insignificant shadow cowering in the remotest distance before the imperial sun. The emperor, from his deathbed, has sent a message to you alone. He has commanded the messenger to kneel down by the bed and has whispered the message to him. So much store did he lay on it that he ordered the messenger to whisper it back into his ear again. Then, by a nod of the head, he has confirmed that it is right. Yes, before the assembled spectators of his death, all the obstructing walls have been broken down, and on the spacious and loftily mounting open staircases stand in a ring the great princes of the empire. Before all these, he has delivered his message. The messenger immediately sets out on his journey, a powerful and indefatigable man. Now pushing with his right arm, now with his left, he cleaves a way for himself through the throng. If he encounters resistance, he points to his breast, where the symbol of the sun glitters. The way, too, is made easier for him than it would be for any other man. But the multitudes are so vast, their numbers have no end. If he could reach the open fields, how fast he would fly, and doubtless you would hear the welcome hammering of his fists on your door. But instead, how vainly does he wear out his strength. Still, he is only making his way through the chambers of the innermost palace. Never will he get to the end of them, and if he succeeded in that, nothing would be gained. He must fight his way next down the stair, and if he succeeded in that, nothing would be gained. The courts would still have to be crossed, and after the courts, the second outer palace, and once more stairs and courts, and once more another palace, and so on for thousands of years. And if at last he should burst through the outermost gate, but never, never can that happen. The imperial capital would lie before him, the center of the world, crammed to bursting with its own refuse. Nobody could fight his way through here, least of all, one with a message from a dead man. But you sit at your window when evening falls and dream it to yourself.
I exercise the creature of earth in the name of the goddess and the god and all of their spirits and demons and all of their creatures and beings. Let nothing that would do us harm enter here. So would it be. I exercise the creature of water in the name of the goddess and the god and all of their spirits and demons and all of their creatures and beings. Let nothing that would do us harm enter here. So would it be. Circle with earth, in the name of the goddess, in the name of the god, in the name of that which gives us life, that which gives us breath, that which feeds us. Which gives us understanding. So mote it be. The circle with water. That which gives us knowledge, that which leads to all, and from which all things come. So mote it be. Do not stray far, always be near, always protect those who understand. I summon, stir, and call the up mighty ones of the West, spirit of water. Come amongst us from afar, join us in this circle and protect these rites. Do not stray far. Always be here. Always protect those who understand. Mother, come amongst us from afar. Join us in the circle and protect these rites. Do Do not go far. Always stay here. Always protect those who understand. So much. The circle is drawn, and all herein are separate and apart from the world's gods. We come. This is where the seed is spawned. This is what the flowers grow from. This is life.
Just inquiring, what kind of a show is this supposed to be?
Fine.
Pardon me?
Well, fine.
Yes, that's right. That's his question, not mine.
Kathleen, I know people think you play a role. Clint Eastwood is a tough guy. Bo Derek is a superwoman.
And Kathleen the witch. Are you real?
Again, I'm not a very good witch. I can't even throw matches into an ashtray. But I am real witch and a real person and really, real, really real, yeah. I'm a witch and I'm a real witch and I guess that's what you're talking about. I'm not a tough guy and I'm not a superwoman and I have cellulite though, like Bo Derek does. But... I'm real. I'm real witch.
How did you become a witch?
Oh, I just waltzed into my local neighborhood witch's house and told her I wanted to join. You know, it was really quite simple. And it was really quite like that, you know. I just happened to find out that I was working at a place where there was a woman who professed to be a witch. And she and I became very close friends and had a lot of talks about it.
And she basically became my tutor, my teacher, and made me see a lot about myself that I didn't see before, and made me think about things I didn't think about before, until I realized that I was really much closer to the earth and the earth religions. And
do you believe in God?
That's kind of a touchy question. It must be a trick question, right? It's just because I don't really know about what you mean by God. And I guess in a way I do, because I believe that if there is a God, then I'm definitely it, and you're definitely it, and they're definitely it, and everybody is part of that thing. It's all part of the same consciousness. It's all part of the same source. You know, Carl Sagan, a scientist, has this phrase that we're all made of star stuff. And that's basically what it is. We're all made of the same thing, and that includes God. So I guess I do. How about you? Do you believe in God?
I guess I do. I like church. It's empty when I go. I walk around. There are so many beautiful Catholic churches in New York. I think you must believe in the devil.
Don't blame all those beautiful Catholic churches on me and say it must be because I believe in the devil. I mean, no, I don't believe in the devil. I mean, first of all, in order to believe in the devil, I think that you probably have to definitely believe in God.
Because most of the people I know who believe in the devil think it's, you know, the God's enemy. That's the only way they can define the devil, really. But I don't see it that way. I think it's a matter of natural dualities, natural...
I've learned that there are many witches living in the United States. What do they say about your playing in public? Doesn't it disturb you?
Yeah, it disturbs me to play in public, because I'm really kind of a private person. I don't like to be so exposed, so to speak. It's just something I prefer. I'd prefer to have very anonymous fame, you know? I mean, it's kind of paradoxical, but I really would prefer that people would maybe know who I am or know what I did, leave some impression on this world, but not know me to look at me, you know? Sit on the subway and have somebody talking about me would be great, and not have them know that they were sitting right next to the person they were talking about. That would be marvelous. But for people to stop me and say things to me, that bothers me. But it doesn't bother me to be doing witchcraft. It just bothers me to be doing anything so publicly. I think witchcraft has to be done publicly. I think people have to come out of their broom closets and get up in front of people and talk about what this is all about. They burned us.
One last question. What would you do if you knew that tomorrow was the end of the world?
Yeah. Everybody thinks it's going to be so catastrophic and terrible. And not necessarily so. Like I said, I think death is just a phase we all go through. And like being a teenager or something. It's nothing terrible. It just happens. And everything that begins ends. And I never expected to live forever. I do expect to be immortal, but I don't expect to live forever.
How about you? What would you do?
I don't believe in the end of the world. I believe in as the world turns. Marika, I'm glad to see you alive again. But you don't know each other. May I introduce you to my colleague?
Marika Meinhof. Marika Meinhof. But you hung yourself, or you were hung a couple of years ago. I don't really remember.
Yes. And at the moment of my death, an alien made love with me. But you know,
oh, well, that's not for me, for them. yeah, there are a few repartees between with Andy Warhol and then she executes the order, shoots him, and there comes an alien who who takes him to the other world. That's it. And we listened to Mozart's Don Giovanni's Viva la Libertà. That was very good to end. The next one is our very first play in the storefront, made in Rotterdam, Holland, 1977. We received a grant. For 3 months, we could do whatever we wanted or thought to come up with. And we wanted to be in a building where we can all be there, because until then, in the West, we were fragmented. All we could never talk to each other, really, just in bits and pieces. And that was a difficult task. Eventually, the building we got had a storefront, and it belonged to the Rotterdam Arts Council, and we had our wish come true, and we immediately saw the possibility of the storefront. Big Child Fire has 5 acts. It's a theatrical concept. The first act is a drama, Dostoevsky, The Devils, you will see. The second is a burlesque, a film burlesque to music. That's most interesting in terms of the window, because what happens in the street is part of the events, you'll see. Part 3 is not on this video anymore. By the way, we did it in 77. The video was made in 1982. Characters changed. Only part 2 and part 5 are the same. The rest is a totally renovated version. So there was a drama, there was a burlesque, there was a letter of Antonin Artaud in 1948 to André Breton. I was reading it. Act 4 was From the Street. Act 4 was a dinner, because the children needed to have dinner. So we had them on stage around the table with a TV set, you'll see, that's still there, all turned on its side. So lights were on, and Peter was videoing, Peter Halasz was videoing the people. So as the children were there with Eva, a mother, right, there was a fifth or sixth person eating dinner. So he was served, and the audience was one by one appearing on the black and white video screen or TV monitor, as it was then. Act 5 is a short farce, The Seventh Clown Story. Two clowns appear. They don't look like clowns, but they are. And they cut a sheet of glass and fire. And that's it. Oh, one more thing, can I say quickly? Big Child Fire is the title because we wanted originally Pigs, Children, and Fire, and Rotterdam Bandit. So we said, all right, then the play title is Big Child Fire.
Service. Maria Lagatkina, a lawful wife, also lived there at the time. My other two lodgings are rented by the month to accommodate my two mistresses. In one I received a high society woman who was in love with me, and in the other her maid. And for some time I toyed with the idea of bringing the two of them together so that the society woman and her servant girl should meet each other in my rooms. While secretly making all the necessary arrangements for that meeting, I had to visit more often one of the two lodgings in a large house in Grokovaya Street, for that was a place where I and the maid used to meet. I had only one room there on the fourth floor, which I rented from some Russian working class people. They themselves lived in the next room, which was much smaller. So much so that the door dividing the two rooms was always open, which was what I wanted. The husband, who was working at some office, was away from morning till night. His wife, a woman about 40, used to cut up old clothes and refashion them into new. And she used to leave the house quite often to deliver her sewing. I remained alone with her daughter, quite a child in appearance. Her name was Matryosha. Her mother loved her, but often chastised her.
And as customary with these people, shouted at her a lot. This little girl waited on me and made up my bed behind the screen. I declare that I've forgotten the number of the house, having made some inquiries recently. I know now that the old house was pulled down and a new and very large house was built in the side of two or three houses. I've also forgotten the name of my landlord. I may have never known it at the time. The flat was in the courtyard. It all happened in June. The house was painted in a light blue color. One day I missed my pen when I moved in. I did not want it at all. It was just lying about there. I told my landlady about it without thinking that she would thrash her daughter for it. But she had been screaming at her daughter for the loss of some rags and had even pulled her hair. But when the rags were found under the tablecloth, the little girl did not utter a word of complaint, but just looked on in silence. It was then that I saw for the first time the little girl's face. She had flaxen hair and a freckled face, quite an ordinary face, but it had a great deal of childishness in it, and it was very gentle, quite extraordinarily gentle. Her mother resented the fact that her daughter did not complain for having been beaten for nothing, and she made as if to strike her with her fist, but stopped herself in time. It was just then that the subject of my penknife came up. There was no one in the flat beside the three of us. The little girl was only one to go behind the screen in my room. The woman flew into a rage for having the first time punished her girl unjustly, rushed up to the bedstand, pulled some twigs out of it, and gave the girl a thrashing in front of me until her body was covered in weals. That in spite of the fact the girl was already in her 12th year. Matryosha did not scream while she was being flogged, because I was there. But she gave a funny sort of sob at each blow. Afterward, she sobbed bitterly for a whole hour. But before that happened, something else caught my eye. At that very moment, my landlady was rushing up to the bedstand to pull out the twigs. I saw my penknife on the bed, and it must have fallen from the table. It occurred to me at once not to tell them about it so that she should be thrashed. I made my decision instantly. At such moments, I begin to breathe heavily. But I'm determined to tell everything without flinching, so that nothing should remain concealed any longer. Crashing over. I put the penknife in my waistcoat pocket, and without uttering a word, left the house and flew away in the street, having first walked a long way so that no one should ever find out. Then I waited 2 days. Having a good cry, the little girl became even more taciturn. Meetings later, I returned to Grokovaya Street. The mother was going out somewhere. Her husband, of course, was not at home. Matt The house was full of workmen all day long, and the sound of hammers and singing could be heard from all the floors. We had already been there for an hour. Mafioshi sat in a small room on a little bench with her back to me and was busy with her needle. At last, she suddenly began to sing softly, as she often did. I took out my watch and saw that it was 2 o'clock. My heart began to pound. I got up and began stealing toward her. I sat down quietly on the floor beside her. She gave a start and looked terribly frightened and jumped up. I took her hand and kissed it, quietly forced her down on the bench again, and began looking in her eyes. The fact that I kissed her hand suddenly amused her like a child, but only for a second, for she jumped up the next moment. This time she looked so frightened that a spasm. Her eyes were motionless with terror, and her lips began to quiver as though she were on the verge of tears. But she did not scream all the same. I kissed her hand again and put her on my knee. Then she suddenly drew back and smiled as if ashamed, but with a kind of wry smile. Her face flushed with shame. I whispered to her, all the time as though drunk. At last, the most strange thing happened to me. Something I shall never forget. Something that quite amazed me. The little girl flung her arms around my neck and all of a sudden started to kiss me anxiously. Her face expressed complete rapture. I nearly got up and went away. So shocked was I to find the sort of thing in a little creature for whom I suddenly felt pity.
All over, she was embarrassed. I did not quite reassure her and no longer caressed her. She looked at me, smiling timidly. Her face suddenly appeared stupid to me. She was getting more and more embarrassed with every minute that passed. At last, she covered her face with her hands and stood motionless in my corner with her face to the wall. Just as I raised myself on my toes, I called that when I sat at the window and looked at the little red spider and then lost count of the time, I had been thinking how I should stand on tiptoe and look through this chain. In putting in the striking detail, I want to prove without a shadow of a doubt to what extent I was clearly in full possession of my mental faculties and how much I'm responsible for everything. I looked through the chain a long time, for it was very dark there, but not so dark as to prevent me at last from seeing what I wanted. At last I decided to leave. I came across a man on the stairs. 3 hours later, we were all drinking tea in our first days in our room and playing with a pack of old cards. All the time I was waiting for something. So it came about that at 11 o'clock, a houseboy of the little builder came running from my landlady in Kobayama Street. The news that Makayoshi had hanged herself. I went to the little girl and saw that the landlady herself did not know why she even sent me. She wailed and screamed hysterically. There were lots of people and policemen. I lay there for a while and then went away. One spring, traveling through Germany a year ago, I absentmindedly went on past the station where I had to change trains and found myself on the long line. I got out at the next station. It was past 2 o'clock in the afternoon, a bright, lovely day. It was a tiny German town. I was shown into a hotel. I had to wait. The next train was not due before 11 o'clock at night. I had an excellent meal, and as I'd been traveling all night, I soon fell sound asleep at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I had quite an extraordinary dream. Suddenly, in the center of that bright, bright light, I beheld a tiny point. Suddenly, the point began taking on a kind of shape, and all at once, I could clearly see a tiny red spider. I immediately remembered the red spider on the leaf of the geranium, which is also made in rays of setting sun. I raised myself and fell on my bed. I saw my Fiocha, emaciated with feverish eyes, exactly as she was when she stood on the threshold of my room and, shaking her head, shook her tiny fist at me. Nothing has ever been so disturbing to me. The pathetic despair of a helpless creature with an unformed mind threatening me. With what? What could she do to me? Nothing like that has ever happened to me. I sat there till nightfall, without moving and forgetful of the time. I do not know, and I cannot tell to this day, that this is what is called remorse or repentance. But what I find so unbearable is the image of her standing on the threshold and threatening me with a small raised fist. Just the way she looked at me then, just the shaking of her head. It is this that I cannot stand, for since then, it has appeared to me almost every day. It does not come itself. I myself summon it up, and it cannot help summoning it up. But I cannot live with it. Why then does not any memory of my life arouse me anything like this? I wandered about after that for almost a whole year and tried to find some occupation. I know that I can dismiss my fiocha from my mind at any time I wish. I'm as much in command of my will as ever, but the whole point is that I never wanted to do so, and I do not want to now. I will go on like that so I lapse into madness. Therefore, I decided to have these pages printed and take 300 copies of them to Russia. When the time comes, I shall send some of them to the police and the local authorities. Simultaneously, I shall send some of them to the editors of all the newspapers with a request to publish them, and to many persons in Petersburg and in Russia who know me. It will also be published in broader translation. I realize that legally I have nothing to fear, not to any considerable extent at any rate. It is I alone who am warring against myself, for I have no accuser. Besides, there is no evidence against me, or what there is extremely slight. There is finally the prevailing idea that I'm not in my right mind, an idea which I'm quite sure my family will make use of in their efforts to squash any legal prosecution that might be dangerous to me. I made this statement, incidentally, in order to prove that I'm in full possession of my mental faculties and realize my position. So far as I'm concerned, it will remain those who know everything, and they will look at me, and I am them. But why everyone's looking at me? I fall back on it as my last resource. If a thorough search were made of in the records of Petersburg police, something might be discovered. My fiancé's parents may still be living in Petersburg. The house, of course, will be remembered. It was painted a light blue color. As for myself, I shall not go anywhere, and for some time, for a year or two, I shall always be found in my mother's safe. If summoned, I will appear anywhere. Nikolai, stop over.
Citizen of the canton before me was hanged there behind the door. On the table I scrapped it with the words. Most of them I did it myself. Beside it on the table lay a hammer, a piece of soap, and a large nail. Evidently prepared in case of need. The strong silk cord with which they're going to hang himself had evidently also been prepared and chosen to fall. It was thickly smeared with soap. All this evidence was premeditation and consciousness of the last minute. The verdict of our doctors after the point of view was that it was most definitely not the case in the Senate.
to take certain corrections to be made in this document. It is time to answer a little. You seem to wish to make yourself out to be worse than your heart would desire. Some passages in your statements are always right. You seem to be admiring your psychology and clutching at every detail, merely with intent on surprising your reader by a callousness, which is not in you. What horrified me was the vast unused energy that was deliberately spent on some other nation. And for the brand itself, many people sin like that, but they live in peace and quiet in their conscience. Even considering it, in other words, they will live without you. They also old men who sin the same way, not taking it seriously, and regarding it as innocent amusement. The old man is full of his horror. But you fed both them of your definition. It is extremely rare. The horror will be general. You need not to stay both false and sincere. People fear of immortality by the same threat. I'm not talking about a few souls. They will be horrified inwardly, but they will not be noticed. But they will be silent. But the laughter will be universal. Not prepared, not hardened. You do not believe. If you believe that you can forgive yourself, then you believe in everything already.
That psychologist.
Thank you.
Thank you.
over.
It's conceptual.
I've only told you 4,000 words.
That's true.
Well, because the early baby and dad, you know, they wouldn't be able to have very well, you know? So they wouldn't have, like, dead animals.
Dead animals? Why wouldn't they have dead animals? And Rob,
let's say, they have to buy stuff to eat.
Hey,
you know what they also did?
The early caveman guys made sculptures with things, and they didn't have that animals.
I don't think... Okay, thank you. Hello. Hello.
We have a
Thank you very much.
Well,
then it didn't
hurt.
I didn't ask.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
So the third piece that we're gonna that we recorded and we did is titled "Mr. Dead and Mrs. Free." It's a it's seven segments of a real film, 16 millimeter that we shot, and seven segments of performance. It's more show-like than anything we ever done before. In the film part, I'd like to emphasize the first 5 minutes, which is a condensed version of a long film that we shot with Larry Solomon in Amsterdam in 1978. And we came up with this quote-unquote horror story. And you will see the film is self-explanatory, so is the play. Have a good time.
Efficiency expert to evaluate his company. After a few weeks, the expert made his report. It was highly favorable except for one thing. It's that man down the hall, said the expert. Every time I go by his office, he's just sitting there with his feet on his desk. He's wasting your money. That man, replied Mr. Ford, once had an idea that saved us millions of dollars. At the time, I believe his feet were planted right where they are now. He is an IBM fellow. His job is to have more ideas like that, but under a very special condition. It's called freedom. We may not always understand what he's doing, much less how he does it, but we do know this. The best way to inspire an IBM fellow is to get out of the way.
Thank you.
to south came the king of Gestapos, lord of the sabotage, ruler of the astronauts, knocking down 50, 60 lanes. Thank you.
Cherry, can you teach me to dance?
Out to south came the king of Gestapos, lord of the sabotage, ruler of the astronauts, knocking down 50-60 lanes. I say for any man make attempt to take me down, he got to first find a rock to kill the sun, overturn the pillar of the space, name the flying camel that I ride on, name the black Scorpio that walked the burning fires of hell, stand in front of the desert and say, I have no fear. I don't fear nothing. God and death got a tombstone opportunity, a graveyard mind. I must be a black Scorpio because I don't mind dying.
Thank you.
451 West Broadway. That's between Houston and Prince Street in Soho. Yes. Okay, well then you can just bring it down and we'll have a look at it. We have to see it first. Fine. Okay, yes we will.
Got a little bit of a problem, but it ain't nothing that
we haven't done before. We all get involved in those kind of situations.
Yeah, but this is the first time for me.
Ron, if you like this girl, why don't you ask her out? Maybe she likes white guys and maybe she don't. You have to feel out the situation. You know what I mean? You see, you're a nice guy, Ron, and sometimes nice guys like you get hurt. You shouldn't feel guilty about it. You like her, ask her out. You do feel guilty about her, don't you?
A little bit.
It's kind of a touchy situation. Maybe you shouldn't get involved.
Maybe you're right.
Don't jump in the water if you can't swim.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
I know I'm right.
After school.
Did you get her there on time this morning?
Everything was all right. You talked to the doctor this afternoon?
Everything's okay.
So anyway.
How are you feeling, babe?
I'm fine.
Good. I called earlier, but there wasn't any answer.
Mm-hmm.
Well, sweetheart.
I gotta go. He's looking at you, kid. You take care of yourself, and I'll see you later.
Thank you.
are kissing each other. I'm lifting up your blouse. I grasp your breath. I stroke both of your breasts. I'm kissing your mouth and neck. At the same time, I'm lifting your skirt up, slipping my hand up. I touch your thigh and the hair on your cunt. I grab your ass. I put my finger in your cunt. I'm playing with your clit. I stroke your cunt deeply inside. You slip your hand in my pants. You stroke my prick. I lean down and suck your breast. I lift up your leg. I'm eating your cunt and sucking your clit. I push my face into your cunt. At the same time, I pull my pants down. I lean down. I put my prick to your breast. I rub my prick between your breasts. You take my prick into your mouth. You suck my prick. You suck and stroke my prick. Put my prick in your cunt. We are fucking. I grab your ass from behind. We fuck till we come. Then we stand up and strip. We kiss and stroke each other till we're aroused. I lie down and you sit on my prick. We move up and down. I watch my privilege go in and out of your cunt. You watch it too. We are fucking. We touch each other's genitals with our hands. I watch your mouth making sound. I raise myself, holding your back until I'm on top of you. We fuck till we come. Then I fall on you. I lick your sweat. Bathtub, we soap and wash each other. We stroke each other with our legs. I push my toe in your cunt. We stroke my cock with your sword. When we're aroused, we get out of the bathtub. You put your hands on the big mirror, spreading your legs. You lean down. I stand behind you and I put my prick in your cunt. We are fucking. I touch your breast from behind and I grab your ass. We watch ourselves in the mirror. We are fucking till we come, making sound.
Dearly loved husband, I want to let you know that I slipped up bad. It ain't my fault, dear husband. You'll still love me after everything. I am in a family way by another one. I know you're good, and you'll forgive me for everything. You talked me into it. He said you wasn't coming home anyway. And I also got a weak moment. You know how weak a woman is. and you can't do anything better but forgive me. It just happened. I was thinking that something must have happened to me since you didn't write a letter for 3 months now. I was scared when your letter came, and you're still alive. I wish that you would forgive me, dear friend. Maybe the baby will die, and everything is swell again. I don't like this man anymore since I know you're alive. Everything costs us so much now. It's good you're not here. But at least on the front, food don't cost you nothing. The money you sent me, I can use. Very necessary. I greet you again, your unforgettable wife, Anne.
Try to move. Hey! Hey, you guys! Cut it out! Cut it out! Hey! Will you quit shooting? We're Company C, Charlie Company. There's only two of us. And he's wounded. Give me a hand. Give me a hand, will you?
You got dog tags?
Sure I got dog tags.
Your name?
Ackerman, 3974287. Okay?
All right, keep your shirt on. We're coming.
Easy, easy. Easy. husband. I let you know that I have slipped up bad. It ain't my fault, dear husband. You'll still love me after everything. I'm in the family way by another one. Everything. He talked me into it and said he wasn't coming home anyway, and also I got a weak moment too. You know how weak a woman is, and you can't do anything better but forgive me. It just happened. I was thinking that something must have happened to you, since you didn't write a letter for 3 months now. I was scared when your letter came and you were still alive. I wish that for you, but forgive me, dear Frank. Maybe the baby will die and everything is swell again. I don't like this man anymore since I know you're alive. Everything costs so much now, it's good you're not here. At least at the front, food don't cost you nothing. The money you sent me, I can use very necessary. I greet you again, your unforgettable wife, Anna.